would Abraham Lincoln plead for a vision that exhibits 1. Childlike curiosity and 2. Exhibits the symmetry in nature, and 3. Is the culmination of a child's visual thinking, whose audiometric analog is, unequivocally, the prelude to also scratches Zarathustra, and is in fact the uncontestable physical theory of E pluribus unum?
Look at the two of us, strangers in many ways. We've got a lifetime to share, so much to say. And as we go from day to day,
history would judge us all extraordinarily harshly if we turned a blind eye to a dictator. History would judge us all extraordinarily harshly if we turned a blind eye to a dictator's wanton use of weapons of mass destruction.
Millions.
And history would judge us all extraordinarily harshly if we turned a blind eye to a dictator's wanton use of weapons of mass destruction.
For all we know, we may never meet again. Before you go, make this moment sweet again. We won't say goodbye until the last minute. I might hold out my hand, check, 'cause my heart's gonna be in it. Oh, for all we know, this may only be a dream. We come and we go like a ripple on a stream. So love me tonight. Tomorrow was made for some. Tomorrow may never come. For all we know, for all we know.
can assure you this, I can help. I got two strong arms, I can help. It would sure do me good to do you good. Let me help. It's a fact that people get lonely, ain't nothing new. But a woman like you, babe, she never have the blues. Let me help. I got two for me. Let me help. You would sure do me good to do you good. Let me help. When I go to sleep at night, you're always a part of my dream. Holding me tight, telling me.
This is not something I'm going to enjoy. Why am I doing it? I have four kids. They're all grown up. They're brave people. They have made their voices heard. My wife is a brave woman. She is making her voices heard. And I think they're simply waiting for me. Where am I? Why aren't I saying something? So I've decided that I will make a little video and put it on my website. It's a rather popular website. Many, many people see it. And I am going to say something now that may make you uncomfortable. It makes me very, very uncomfortable. But here it is. I'm going to read it. This may well be the most important target for our protests. Personally, it scares me more than anything else the Orange Godzilla has done. Please, don't ignore it, and please respond with action. Thank you.
We have an outstanding panel of contributors to this question of what is quantum gravity, and I was asked to give a few opening remarks just to get us started. So as you've already heard, one of the dramatic developments in the subject is that we now know, at least in certain toy models, that space-time itself has constituents that we can identify, that it consists of strongly interacting quantum mechanical degrees of freedom, living in fewer dimensions. And this is precise in toy models and extends, at least in an approximate way, to more realistic situations, such as accelerating universes, a subject which has had infusion of both data and theoretical developments in terms of the very active area now of the microscopic construction and formulation of accelerating cosmologies. Now, both these aspects of the subject have had a huge infusion of progress from KITP workshops. In particular, the first aspect, including the ADS-CFT correspondence, was hashed out. The further developments after the original idea were hashed out in a big way at the string theory workshop at the ITP in 98. And this more recent subject of string vacuum constructions and moduli fixing and such were hashed out in the later KITP.
And this would presumably be the exact description that takes into account all the effects that are happening in the singularity. Of course, this is just a dream. We don't know how to do this yet, but maybe it's something we might achieve in the next 25 years. Thank you very much.
Okay, we can clap for Juan because he didn't take his full time. Next speaker is Leonard Susskind.
Congratulations, David. David and I have been friends for 40 years now. You realize that? 40 years. I was thinking on the way over here, coming down here, how I would help celebrate this event. And I thought to myself, gee, what should I do to show David how much I admire him and so forth? And I decided that in honor of David, I would not use the term anthropic principle for the next 6 minutes. Frank? Oh, is Frank leave? Was he feeling ill? Was he feeling sick? I noticed yesterday he didn't look so good. I thought maybe his head looked a little swollen. Anyway. How many, have I used my 5 minutes yet? What's that? This is hopeless. There's no way to do this. What I've decided to do is to just show you my transparencies and let you figure them out yourself. So my first one is a summary of the standard model. I hope everybody knows what a Rube Goldberg machine is. Oh, well, I have the same problem that, oh, there it is. Okay, is that right? Oh, I see. I have to stand upside down. Okay. That's the standard model for you. It's a clumsy, overly complex, confusing thing that has no simplicity, no elegance, but it works. It works. How does it work? Among other things, it works in that it provides the basis for chemistry, nuclear physics, biology, you and me. I didn't say the word. Now, I have a quick summary also of cosmology. Here it is. Cosmology. Ah, damn it. Cosmology, all of it, is a roll from a large vacuum energy, a relatively large vacuum energy, to a small vacuum energy, and at both ends, it's incredibly fine-tuned. The only good things to say about these fine-tunings, if they weren't there, we wouldn't be here. Third transparency. Now, let's see if I can get this right. Yeah. Third transparency comes from string theory. What we've been discovering about string theory over the last X number of years is that it's very complicated. It has a huge number of vacuums. And more recently, we've been discussing non-supersymmetric vacuums. Again, the space of them, which is now called the landscape, appears to be exceedingly complicated. Of course, we don't know this yet, but we seem to be finding that it's extremely complicated, with something possibly like 10 to the 500 vacuums, such that the parameters of the theory, such that the vacuum energies and cosmological constants, all the other constants of nature, seem to form what we call a discriminum. That's a play on the word continuum, that they're so dense that they almost form a continuum. Why is this? The reason is because string theory is very complicated. That's the reason. It doesn't matter which way you show this. For the non-experts, that's a Calabi-Yau manifold, I am told. Some projection of it. They're very complicated. They have many, many parts, very, very many moduli, coordinates, and so forth. And whenever a configuration space has hundreds of degrees of freedom, it's likely that the number of ground states or metastable ground states will be exponential in that. It's true in molecular physics. That's why protein folding is so hard. And it's true probably in string theory, just many, many. Much more than enough. All right, so what picks among all these vacuums? What picks among all these vacuums is a concept that string theorists have invented, which is called the vacuum selection principle. But the vacuum selection principle, like the Holy Grail and the Loch Ness Monster, has never been seen. It has never been seen by human beings, and some of us suspect it doesn't exist, that there is no vacuum selection principle, but instead something else replaces it. Every vacuum occurs. Eternal inflation, bubble nucleation of metastable vacuums producing more metastable vacuums, producing more metastable vacuums inside other vacuums, until you simply populate this entire landscape. Someplace in the universe, or someplace in the megaverse, or whatever it's called, everything occurs. That's the basic layout of what's called the landscape approach to physics. Is it correct or isn't it correct? Well, let me formulate it as two questions. The first question, and in my own opinion, incidentally, is that all of cosmology and particle physics and string theory turn on these particular questions. The first is simply, does this landscape really exist? We certainly haven't understood it with the same level of precision that we understand other vacuums of string theory. So this is probably an answerable question. Mathematical physicists like Shamit Kashru and our friends at Stanford, Eva, Michael Douglas, and others are examining this question, and I think in time we will definitely know the answer. Does it exist or doesn't it exist? The second question appears harder to me, whether this concept of eternal inflation, bubble nucleation, can really be made crystal clear in the context of, let's say, string theory. I'm finished. That's it. I was going to make some predictions, but I won't make them. All right. The prediction is the answers to the questions will be yes. And the other prediction is that in time, string theorists, including Ed Witten, will eventually begin to see this as a good thing and begin to realize this is the greatest strength of their own theory. Thank you. What?
Thank you very much, Lenny. Our next speaker is Professor Atift.
Okay, so freedom are unphysical, somehow has been transformed into unphysical, unobservable elements of the theory, which are just gauge transformations. You can also say, thank you, you can also say as you, if you insist on describing space and time as a continuum, that there's a kind of, the information loss implies that two high frequency modes are rapidly disappearing from the spectrum because of some sort of dissipation. So frequencies higher than the frequency of these levels will simply disappear. So this is a kind of picture that comes out that, to my mind, seems to be making a lot of sense. So from black holes, we arrive at a picture of space-time where can possibly understand why we today find an effective quantum theory that looks like quantum mechanical, but actually it is it could be based, starting from a deterministic theory, you might end up with a very coherent picture. What I like about it is that it might possibly restore some notion of locality, which, as we learn from most string theorists, is completely not there in that present view. I think we have to restore some notion of locality just to get logical coherence in all these theories. But I should stop here, as I've been told by the chair of this session. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And our last but not least, we have Kamran Vatha.
Okay, thanks for the invitation and congratulations to KITP and to Dave. I'm going to talk about some aspects of string theory which has recently emerged and in line with trying to swallow up other kinds of fields. Quantum foam is one of them, and I'm going to talk about the connection between string theory and quantum foam. So as we know, moving from Newtonian mechanics to Einstein's theory, we are replacing flat space with curved space-time. And the quantum theory of gravity has been rather difficult to formulate due to the ultraviolet divergences, and as it reviewed, string theory has emerged as a prime candidate to resolve these problems, and we have a well-defined perturbative formulation of quantum gravity in the context of string theory. And we have these beautiful diagrams of string theory connecting up and moving and joining, so it's a very pretty picture of how this happens, and we have a nice geometric formulation of quantum theory of gravity, at least perturbatively. And it's also mathematically very rich, but it doesn't answer one important question that was said a long time ago by Wheeler, that simple analysis of quantum theory mixed up with gravity suggests that something is happening very widely at the Planck scale of order of 10 to minus 33 centimeters. And the observation that he made was that we expect that at the Planck scale, the space will look very, very non-smooth and very foamy. And these fluctuations of topology and geometry at different scales should happen if you just do a back of an envelope calculation in the context of mixing quantum theory with gravity. But it doesn't answer one important question that was said a long time ago by Wheeler, that simple analysis of quantum theory mixed up with gravity suggests that something is happening very widely at the Planck scale of order of 10 to minus 33 centimeters. And the observation that he made was that we expect that at the Planck scale, the space will look very, very non-smooth and very foamy. And these fluctuations of topology and geometry at different scales should happen if you just do a back of an envelope calculation in the context of mixing quantum theory with gravity. And these kind of fluctuations would inevitably change topologies because you would pass through singularities and you have to see what happens after that. So you have to end up with a big, big configuration space of different topologies and geometries which looks like a mess. And that's what naive description of quantum gravity would suggest. And these kind of fluctuations would inevitably change topologies because you would pass through singularities and you have to see what happens after that. So you have to end up with a big, big configuration space of different topologies and geometries which looks like a mess. And that's what naive description of quantum gravity would suggest. And the observation that he made was that we expect that at the Planck scale, the space will look very, very non-smooth and very foamy. And these fluctuations of topology and geometry at different scales should happen if you just do a back of an envelope calculation in the context of mixing quantum theory with gravity. So space and time should look like some kind of a quantum foam at the Planck scale has been the idea. And so we expect that all quantum theory of gravity somehow have some notion of this sum over these foams, at least in the Euclidean formulation, where you rotate the time to imaginary time, you expect some kind of a statistical mechanical ensemble of which would mean to be corresponding in one-to-one to some kind of fluctuations geometries of topologies. So string theory, when it's perturbatively meaningful, it is too big, despite the fact that we think of strings as too small in the accelerator physics. In the context of Planck physics, it's too big when the string perturbation is valid to see the quantum form. So when we talk about Planck scale, it's much, much smaller than the string scale. So the fact that string theory has not seen the Planck scale so well is not a criticism of string theory, because strings are too big, it's too coarse an object to see something going on at such a small scale, the quantum scale of the gravity. And whenever you try to probe that scale, whenever you get to the quantum Planck scale, the string perturbation, the coupling constant of string theory has been adjusted so much that string perturbation is not valid anymore. So precisely when you try to ask a question, what is going on at Planck scale, from the string context, string perturbation breaks down. So it's consistent that string theory could live well with a quantum theory of gravity with a foam-like structure at Planck scale. So it modifies, string theory modifies the classical geometry to what's called the stringy geometry. An example of it was mentioned with Ed's talk called mirror symmetry. So it gives you a new geometry, but that new geometry is still smooth, surprisingly. So it replaces a classical geometry with a stringy smooth geometry. And it may be hard to believe that there is a quantum form description in string theory, that a bumpy quantum form at the Planck scale is somehow averages out magically to give us this smooth geometry that we talk about as an emergent space-time. However, precisely this has happened recently. In a simplified class of string theories, which is called topological string theories, it has been recently shown that string theory is consistent with the quantum form picture. But it doesn't answer one important question that was said a long time ago by Wheeler, that simple analysis of quantum theory mixed up with gravity suggests that something is happening very widely at the Planck scale of order of 10 to minus 33 centimeters. And so it's ironic that we have started with the crystals as made of atoms and elementary particles, and those being made of strings, and strings made of atomic crystal space-time form. It's quite ironic that this has repeated itself, and it's natural to expect that string theory will, the notion of quantum form will extend to the full superstring, that we can have a quantum form description of the full superstring theory. Thank you.
Like the Bible. I later told this to Adonis Susskind, and he said, yeah. Okay, so that's what I'll put on there now. And then they can check with Joe Kane. He told me where he lives, about 60 kilometers outside of Munich, and he teaches on the web. He teaches languages. Really pretty good. So that adds to the importance of what's in the bag. And if he knows that, certainly Ukraine knows it.
So I'm trying to lose once again.
All right. That's all right.
That's acceptable.
Okay, okay.
Make no mistake, this is a grab by a clever, devious, and power-hungry man. It is a pooch. This may well be the most important target for our protests. Personally, it scares me more than anything else the Orange Godzilla has done. Please, don't ignore it, and please respond with action. Thank you.